And my background, really briefly, is, you know, I came here a long time ago. I didn't know anybody, knocked on every door, begged to work for free everywhere. Worked as a production assistant for a long time for free, and just kept moving my way up through commercials and music videos, and used to clean up Michael Bay's coffee spills while he was still directing Nike commercials. You know, worked for RSA, which is Ridley Scott's company. The Pitka Brothers, which were a huge commercial production company back then, all the big music video places like Propaganda, and then moved into television and got fortunate to work over to Amblin. So, you know, Steven was my boss for about 4 years there, doing things for NBC. So at that time, I was doing a lot of post-heavy work there, so like post-coordinating, supervising a lot of deliveries for NBC. So he was a great mentor. You know, work with, actually he gave me $1,000 towards my first short film a long, long time ago that I did while I was there at Amblin. And then from there went over to Fox, and from Fox was with Chris Carter at 1013 Productions, working on X-Files films and Harsh Realm, a television series there. Then from there back over to, I was at Warner for a bit, and then over at Universal. And as is pretty normal in town, you know, you move from studio to studio depending on what project you're working on. So I have worked at all the major studios, and then back at Universal. I'm sorry, I was over at Playtone before coming back to Universal Amblin, so the Universal lot. But Playtone is Tom Hanks' company, so I did a lot of HBO series for Tom. Great to have him as a boss for about 3 years. Did the From the Earth to the Moon series and started prepping on Band of Brothers before I left from there. And then I was doing a lot of stuff in China starting in like 99. And that, you know, was producing, directing things. And I really got more into the money stuff just a couple of years ago from Playtone. Then I went back over to Universal. I was over at Universal about the past 5 or 6 years. And left there about a year and a half ago when I was asked to run the Hamptons Group, which is a private equity investment firm out of Hamptons, New York, obviously. And we have some Chinese matching funds in that also. And I think it's just from producing over the years that, you know, people kept coming back to me and saying, you know, we think you're good at keeping our numbers, you know, where they should be. Here we have this amount of money. We'd like to put it into something. Any recommendations and so on. And that over the past few years just led me to get more into the finance end of it and go ahead and establish that particular film fund with the Hamptons Group. And then I work with another one out of Chicago, which is just a private individual wealthy family organization. And they're always looking for particular projects. And then worked together with another Chinese partner for Shanghai New Culture, which we put some money recently into Skip Trace, into the Jackie Chan movie that's out last year. Have been doing, going around doing sales on that, you know, over the past 6 or 7 months. And then currently we are now starting to look into doing an EB-5 film fund.
Cool.
EB-5, if you're not aware of that, that is basically foreign investment into United States companies that have to create a certain number of jobs. And the people that put up that foreign investment, therefore, are entitled to a green card into the United States. So you've probably heard of a lot of people from China doing that, putting in their $500,000. Minimum investment, which may go up to 800 next year, but and for that, them and their family members do get that visa as long as the projects you've invested into has created the right number of jobs. So currently putting together a film fund like that and looking for projects for that one as well too. So
cool.
You know, as is the case in the business, you kind of do anything and everything to keep yourself going.
Okay, many people don't do that much. You won the game. Actually, I do want to take a moment to say thank you so much for the Earth to the Moon. It's I and my husband's absolutely it sounds terrible, but there are a few things that you just watch literally over and over and over again, and on a really bad day, you just go, I'm just gonna go watch From the Earth to the Moon, because we went to the moon that one time.
I'm glad to hear that. There was lots of you know, blood, sweat, and tears working on that all the time. It's basically like making six feature films, you know, in a very short amount of time with deadlines. It's, you know, it's a difficult thing doing those miniseries. You know, HBO has great quality stuff. And they had asked me after that series to consider being VP of post over there. but I turned that down because I was going over to China. But it's great to hear people are still loving that. It's a great series.
It is a great series. It's a landmark series, I think. So I think if it's okay, I'd like to take, and maybe this is a question that you can't really answer because you do represent sort of a lot of different financial sources, but if you could sort of give me a notion of at the moment, and just not because I want anybody to pitch you, and not, but just because I want to get a sense of what kinds of films you fund and what your preferred budget range is, so the people listening to us know that the answers that you're providing are true for that
Right, kind of project,
right? Because it is, you know, if somebody says, if and I don't know that there are such people, but somebody who's funding $100 million or $300 million films, the development process and so forth for that is going to be significantly different than for somebody who says, you know, well, my favorite films are between 1 and 10 million, you know, and that, because right. It limits how much money you're spending on pre-production and development. So can you sort of give the types of films that you like in terms of genre and sort of the preferred budget range that you enjoy?
Well, it's not so much of what I enjoy, it's just what our business model is. And business model, particularly for Hamptons Group, is we look to put out three films a year. Basically, the fund, we turn over about $165 million a year. So we'll roll that over in 5 years to, you know, I would say about, you know, $750 million, and we'll roll that over as revenue comes in and goes back out, back into financing projects. So the business model for that particular fund is looking for, first off, three films a year is what the goal is, but we're not mandated to have three. It really comes down to if we think we're going to make money off of them. That's the bottom line for it. I'd rather hold on to the money and not spend it than spend it. Fortunately, I don't have, on that particular fund, I don't have capital calls that I have to meet. And certainly because, you know, when you're not spending people's money, they're not making money, right? So on one of the other funds, I have to spend a certain amount of money within a certain amount of time. But for Hamptons, looking at three films a year, you know, we look for one being something that I can bring back to the studios and partner with there. You know, I go to Universal first with things. We potentially look at things on studio slates that they already have. So we kind of don't normally tend to find a project that's franchisable that, you know, we can bring in sort of to add to a studio slate. We more so look at the studio slate already to see what they have and see what they need co-financing on. But if somebody does bring us a great, you know, concept or project, I'll certainly, you know, take it back to the studios as well too and see if we can get it on somebody's slate. So I would say, you know, we look for something on the studio side that is in the 60 to maybe $75 million range. Then we'd look for a lower budget project that would be in about a $30 million range. And that's something that has to have international marketability to it for sure. And then we always like to leave an opening for something that's in the 5 to 10 range that could be a sleeper. That was one of the reasons why we agreed to read scripts from the Capital Fund screenplay competition is because they get material from all over the world. So we're happy to find another Slumdog Millionaire that we can make for 5 or 6, you know, and come out of the box office with our, you know, 25 to 30. So we don't really try to, we don't really limit the range, but we definitely don't look at things under 5 million, put it that way.
That's cool. And then and so a project like Purge, like the, I think the first Purge was in like the $4 to $5 million yeah. range. That would have been something that you would have taken a look at. Do you have sort of genre preferences that you like? Do you look at horror, thriller?
Basically we look at everything except for a localized comedy. You know, if there's too many references, you know, that only people in a particular country are going to understand. Like we wouldn't look at a British comedy, right? Because we just can't sell it far and wide enough for us to make back the money that we need to fit the business model. We would look at a comedy that, you know, could work in multiple territories, but not anything that is too local. Other than that, we really keep it open as far as genres go.
Cool. And you, but and so that means that a little Miss Sunshine or a Juno, which might tend to be sort of American focused, because it talks about American issues and American everything else, is not, it's not going to be as attractive as something like a Purge or a Halloween, which is more universal, or you know, even just a random ghost story, because he at least in the scares. Is that correct?
Yes.
Very cool.
That's true. I would say it's generally true. I mean, Juno is a tad more on the more possibility side, just because, you know, that's about, you know, growing up and, mm-hmm. you know, that demographic, you know, that does have universal kind of issues around the world for that age group. Mm-hmm. Something like mm-hmm. Little Miss Sunshine, which is a great film, but very quirky and just very sort of, I don't know, Amerocentric, or, you know, mm-hmm. particularly where it was located. That's not something that we would invest into. Yes, as you said, we much prefer mm-hmm. to put it into another Purge. Yeah.
Right. So in the, and you mentioned demographic, do you have a target demographic for your films? Are you always focused, if all other things being equal, at the sort of 18 to 24 like PG-13 to R, and 18 to 24, or 18 to 44, or something like that. I mean, sort of, do you have target demographics that you have in terms of age and MPAA rating?
We don't, because we try to look at a more holistic approach by saying, okay, who is this movie for, number one, and then what other kind of revenue streams can we get, you know, from this product? So mm-hmm. it may be only for, you know, the 12 to 15 or 16 year old audience, but if we're able to get the right product placement, if we're able to do the right, you know, social media, you know, marketing and be running other revenue streams, or get a, you know, mm-hmm. go ahead and produce a game that we're able to get out into a toy product. Mm-hmm. You know, we look at all of that to say, is the profit, you know, projection enough that we should go ahead and put the money in, even though it's a, you know, more niche market, let's say. Mm-hmm. We're not always looking to get just the 18 to 24s because, you know, they spend the most amount of money or whatever. No, it's just whatever has the highest profit margin potential is what we look at.
Actually, I am on a scale of 1 to 10, 400 happy, because you put the words, I tell people that all of the time. I go, you know, the thing is that if you're producing a book, if you're producing a movie, why on God's green earth would you not have at least a book? I mean, it's like, why would you not? I mean, you've got all that intellectual property. It'd be a shame not to use it. And when you talk about those merchandising opportunities that you just reviewed, like if you were producing Purge, you know, you would like to see a Purge game as well. When you talk about your $5 million budget or your $30 million budget, are you talking, should the producer come to you with those elements as part of their business plan, or should they come to you saying, this, I think this can be used as a game, and then you guys will go off and sell those rights to you'll let them produce the film, and then you guys will go off and do the negotiation to create those auxiliary projects?
Yeah, we would consider either or. The thing that I would sort of mm-hmm. warn against mm-hmm. is doing what I constantly see, and that is, you know, with presentations or, you know, pitch packages. You know, every single person says, oh, and it will make an awesome game. Oh, and it will, you know, we'll have an awesome app for it and whatever. If you don't either have a deal with somebody already who has that in development or has said, yes, we will do it. You know, like if you don't have EA saying, yes, absolutely, we'll do it. We love it. Here's the amount of money we'll spend on it. Here's when we would release it. Here's, you know, the marketing dollars that we'll put into it. If you don't have either a commitment like that from somebody, or if you don't have the actual game done because you went out and did it on your own to save money or whatever, that's fine. But just don't come and say, oh, it would make a great game, you know, or it would be a great app. Everybody says their thing is going to be great for every other revenue stream. You know what I mean? It's either show it to me that it is great. Like, yes, it did make a great app because you made it, or show me that other people already believe that too. And it's not just you, you know, saying how beautiful your baby is, because I think most people say my baby's beautiful, right?
Right, that's totally true. So, that makes actually perfect sense. So, if somebody brought you another Purge, and it was like going to be a $5 million film, and you guys saw the opportunity to turn it into a game or an app or whatever, would you then take the opportunity? Would you say, okay, we'll fund your film subject to the fact that we're simultaneously acquiring the rights to use the content for this other purpose? In other words, do you do that packaging, or does the producer bring that to you? I guess what I'm trying to say is, do you want the producer to actually go to do the legwork to build those other relationships, or do you see those relationships and then build them because you're in a position, you've created those relationships with other people?
Right. Well, we fortunately have those relationships. So, you know, if we see a project, like, you know, currently I'm looking at a project, I can't say too much about the content, but basically it has a lot of, I'll just say, folkloric, mythical, superhero-esque characters, right? Mm-hmm. So the producers who brought that, you know, they don't have anything in place anywhere, you know, to try and make extra revenue off of that. But of course, when I see that, you know, me and my team right away, we say, oh, that'll make a great game, right? Mm-hmm. Well, then we, you know, call around town or up Silicon Valley, the normal people we deal with, and say, hey, you know, here's, you know, a project that we have, you know, give us roundabout numbers on doing a game that's, you know, has this amount of interactivity, or if we're just going to release it for, you know, home consoles or versus online, et cetera. We get the numbers on that, and then we would go back to the producers and say, okay, yes, we want to take the project, and it's worth it for us to go ahead and offer you, you know, buying out these other rights as well. Sometimes we don't want to do that or don't care to do it because we don't think it would make a good, let's say, game or app, or some other kind of potential revenue stream. And we say, well, you know, good luck. Hopefully you guys can make some extra money doing it yourself. So sometimes we're interested, sometimes not.
Cool. That makes total sense. All right. So I guess one of the things we talked about when I emailed you is I sent you over sort of the step-by-step development process that after so I've been doing this for about 2 years, so I've interviewed a whole bunch of people, and I have distilled what I think is a good development process for a film between $1 to $10 million. So and I emailed it to you, and I thought we might want to swiftly sort of walk through the steps in that thing so that you can say, yeah, that make, you know, yes, this process sort of makes sense, or no, it doesn't make sense. Because the objective of that process is to generate for investors a package that is fundable, and to create that package as swiftly and as cost effectively as possible so it's kind of no wasted motion or movement or time for the producer. So does that seem like it'd be an okay thing to talk about?
Yeah, and I did take a look at it. And as I mentioned a little bit earlier before the call, I think, you know, it's a that's a very good starting point and outline. You know, I hate to say that I unfortunately often revert to the same answer that I always hated to hear when I was trying to find information coming up as well, which was like, you know, when somebody asks you, well, how do you get an agent or how do you find a movie? Well, there's about a million ways to do both of those things, right? Unfortunately, there's no one standard way. But I think you're covering the bases of what, you know, minimally you want to do. So I think you have a great outline there, you know, and I think as people hear what you have on your outline, I think people should just keep in mind that not every single thing is going to apply to your particular project. So, you know, you don't want to waste a lot of time and resources for something that doesn't fit your project. You really have to think about your project in particular, you know.
Right.
So, yeah, let's go through it.
All right, cool. And the other thing is that the one of my objectives in developing the strategies or the outline is basically to make it so that you start out and you go, what you're really doing is determining the viability of the project sort of early on before you wander off into spending large quantities of money on it. Because I think both you and I have seen people who have literally spent years producing projects for which there was no market. Like, it was never going to get distribution. You could have said that was never going to get distribution, like, 2 days in, like 2 days, like from the script. He's like, no, this is never going to happen. And then alternatively, I've seen people who had a great project and managed to kill it. Like, by creating attachments or dependencies on it, they basically went around telling people it was a $30 million film and it wasn't. And it's like, okay, well now you set up all of these things. You've created these, you said these things that have encumbered this project, and it's hard to, to strip those things off because you've made commitments to people that are going to be problematic for everybody. So, the first thing is you acquire the script, and I'm assuming that you think it was okay if somebody optioned the script, as long as the option was a really good, you know, was a good, strong, executable option, or they've purchased the script, or they've written the script themselves, and they can demonstrate that they own all rights to it because they've registered it at the copyright office. Is that true?
Yeah, I mean, as long as you have good chain of title on it, you know, which you're going to need for all distributors anyway, as long as you have that from the get-go, you know, that's good for us, number one. But, you know, I know that maybe there's, I don't know if it's all producers that are in the audience, or maybe there's some producer writers.
There's writer producers, writer producers and actor producers and filmmakers. So, yeah, we have of all varieties at the moment.
Yeah, so I would say if you're a producer and you're, you know, looking for a project to, you know, take to, you know, the money folks, yeah, certainly you have to have that very solid, you know, option deal that we're going to want to look at, we're going to want to see, you know what I mean? Because we don't want to start going down that road at all if it's not something you've written, if you don't have chain of title, if you've, you know, if you're a producer and you've got 10 or 12 projects, you know, in your pocket, and you just, you know, like, oh, I've got this one, you know, the first thing we're going to do is say, okay, let's make sure you've got a good option on it, because we don't want to take the time if you don't really have it, or if there's going to be problems, or if there's other encumbrances on the project, you know, already that we need to know about up front.
I think I believe that 100%. It's important to make sure that your agreements are the kind of agreements that are going to make the project stable over the course of the whole, you know, through from now until then, you know, all the rights have been exploited, you know, in what might be 3, 4, 5, 10 years. I mean, it's just.
Yeah, I mean, if you're a producer, you don't want to start going to money people because you have a friend's script and you've said to your friend, hey, I'll try and get money for it, I'll try and make it, and blah, blah, blah. You know, don't do that don't take it to investors and use up that opportunity of that meeting, unless you're going to be able to show them, you know, that option, you know, in a follow-up email or leave behind material, or you're going to be able to send it over to our legal department so that they can take a look at it. You don't want to end up having to go back to your friend now and saying, or whoever the writer is or whoever the property owner is, and saying, wow, I have this company, they really have some strong interest in it. Let's do an option agreement now. And then you have to, you know, sort of fight and bicker, and maybe you don't get the option now. Mm-hmm. And then you don't look good to the investor when you can't go back and say, gee, I don't have the right paperwork on this, and the writer doesn't want to do it this way, and whatever. I mean, you don't want to be putting yourself in that position, you know what I mean? So get that stuff done, taken care of before you go out and start trying to pitch it to money people.
Right. I think that's very, very sound advice. So the next step is, in my list, is get good coverage. And I think it's a step that people a lot of times want to skip. But I think if you get, there's a reason that the whole industry uses readers. And that's because they are objective, but informed opinions. So, and I recommend WeScreenplay.com, but I think you also mentioned that the competition that you recommended is, I think, also a very good way to get coverage as well, because your group actually runs a competition, and one of the benefits of participating in the competition is coverage.
Yeah, we don't run the competition, but we were asked by them to be the judges and readers. So, our equity firm, and I think there's about 10 to 12 other, film finance groups that are actually the readers that read all the material that comes into that, the Capital Fund Screenplay Competition. Okay. But they also do provide coverage there at that competition. And we started using actually their coverage services also for things that we get in, just because we've liked the coverage that we've read from them so much in the past. But I think you also mentioned We Screenplay and Slated and a few others, that have good coverage. So certainly you want to get good coverage from, from a good source. And I think you put it perfectly that they are objective but informed. Everybody just, coverage is just people's opinion, and we've all seen coverage, that totally contradicts, coverage on the same script. But, literally time is such a factor that you need the coverage regardless, just so that you can know what the summary of the film is. You can see what kind of locations you'd have to be paying for. You can see any kind of seasonal things that are going to be involved in the script. You can get an overall, feel for the look, style, and scope of the thing out of the coverage, so you can decide, well, that really isn't too popular anymore, or, oh, this is starting to become more, more popular, let's say, in Asia. So, yes, we want to look at this one, right? You can get that out of the coverage regardless of, what they're saying about the plot or characters or, the structure of the writing. It gives us a lot of other information that we want to have right up front before we even consider taking the 2 hours to read through the thing line by line. Mm-hmm. So, yes, I would certainly recommend getting coverage.
Right. And I also think one of the things I like about We Screenplay, and I think it's true for a lot of coverage services, but including Slated, is the fact that they give you multiple coverages. So if you have three or five people that are reading your script and all of them call out the same thing, maybe the case that you want to keep that thing, it's like, it's kind of your hook or something like that. Like, Quentin Tarantino, he's probably going to get that this is way too violent, like a lot. But the point is that if you're getting a note that is negative, that you don't expect, and you're getting it from multiple readers, it gives you information that you can use to make that fix, so that the next time you get it read, you don't get that note. I mean,
I was going to say, getting it from a couple different sources, is a good idea. So maybe you get one from a competition, maybe you get one from, regular service, one from someplace else, so you can see if different kinds of readers are giving you the same feedback. It's the same thing that we often do, if we're doing any, market screenings at all. We'll do some market screenings sometimes in Cannes or Berlin. We just did some in Toronto on some things just on the first with the director's cut of projects. And so we look to see if we are getting the same feedback about any particular thing in the film. And if you are, as you said, which I totally agree with, then that's an area to look at. You may decide, well, that's fine, but at least you know that everybody is, you know, noticing that particular thing, better or worse.
Right, exactly. And I think that's very important information. So the next thing I recommend people do is run film analytics for the film. And I just did an interview with Bruce Nash from thenumbers.com. I think Nash Analytics, or what is the name of his company? Anyway, Bruce Nash from thenumbers.com. And the cost of coverage is the cost of analytics is $500 to $1,500. And depending upon where you're getting the coverage from, one of the things it covers is, and provides in significant detail, is comps and also the distributors that are currently distributing projects, some, you know, that are similar to or in the same budget and genres that you're planning on distributing. And the reason that I think this is a key step is that you do it before, I think you should do that before you do the budget, because usually you'll know, have a general idea what the budget is, or you can have a line producer read it and just say, yeah, I think that we're looking at 2 to 3 million, or we're looking at 5 million here. But if you, I think if you spend the money to do the budget before you do the film analytics, you run into the problem of, you don't know how much you have to make the film make. If you do the analytics for something, and it says, okay, this thing is going to make at most, you know, I think it's projecting, you know, five to 7 million. Well, then that $10 million film isn't going to be a $10 million film. So that means you have to take that into account during the budgeting process. So do you think running film analytics at this point makes sense?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, if you have, you know, it's like when we used to do, I mean, as a producer, I would do, you know, tons of presentation packages and put in comps and all the things you just mentioned, which now companies, you know, they're standalone companies, as you mentioned, you know, that do the analytics part for you, and can be much more accurate about it than, you know, going through trades, you know, they're accessing their data from Box Office Mojo and other places. And you can do all that too, you know, if you don't want to use an analytics company. So I think it is good for sure to do the analytics before you include your budget. You know, it's just like any business is going to do, you know, here's our projections, you know, you're always looking at your, you know, those projections before you're deciding how much you're going to spend. Right. So, mm-hmm. Yeah, I would agree. You want to do that first.
Right. And also do you personally, as an investor, take, if the numbers are being run by a company like Film Analytics or by Bruce Nash or by Slated or by people who are acknowledged to be leaders in this particular field, does it matter? Do you find their forecasts more persuasive, or is it the case that if somebody ran up, if you know, because when those guys submit, have analytics, they actually sign them. That's like one of the things that you're buying, is the fact that you had this expert take a look at it. And in a sense, the numbers are coming from an informed source as opposed to the person making it up themselves. Is it meaningful to you when you see somebody else's name on the analytics?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, honestly, I mean, we're going to run it ourselves as well. You know, we wouldn't. I'm sorry. Am I still on the line?
Yeah, you are. So you would. So you would.
Okay. Internally, of course, we're always going to do that. And you know what is, you know, our best numbers and gauges always comes from just our direct, you know, calls over to our distributors in certain territories. You know, saying, okay, I've got this. How much you think it, you know, it's going to bring in? Because you know, the analytics. You know, I don't know when they were done. I don't know exactly what they were based off of. Mm-hmm. It'll say, I mean, it's not a bad thing, mm-hmm. But, you know, that's like somebody saying, you know, here's this car and I think it can run, you know, and this mechanic told me it can, mm-hmm. it can run another 100,000 miles. I'll say, well, that's fine, but I'm going to take it to my mechanic too, right? Because we've worked together with them, we trust them, blah, blah, blah. I don't know you know, your mechanic, right, or where they're basing their projections off of.
Right.
So we're always gonna do it ourselves. So it's not a bad thing to have them included. I think, quite honestly, they're more helpful and informative for you as the producer, so that you can make better decisions, number one, about, you know, how to really be doing your budget line by line, and where you need to move some costs from, you know, one line item to another one.
Mm-hmm.
And also it can help you be more confident in negotiations with somebody, you know, who is, you know, wanting to take the property, but they're only wanting to, you know, give you X amount for it, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, it can help you as the producer, you know, for you to say, you know what, no, I really agree with these analytics, and I think I can get a better deal someplace else, so I'm going to go there, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I think they probably are more informative for the producer than they are for the investor, honestly.
Yeah, I think it's a matter of what kind of they're critical to the producer, and I think including them in the package, given that you have them, doesn't create, at least it looks like you're doing a workmanlike job of trying to do the numbers right.
Right.
I think it makes sense that that you would do your own, you would have your own analysis done, just because you have a different set of contexts to collect that information. So,
right. Well, and back, I was going to say, I'll just add to that, you know, back in the day, you know, everybody sort of used the same comps all the time. You would see in different packages for different films, you'd see the same comps used for, you know, if it was a horror picture, you'd see the same set of comps in there,
mm-hmm.
In every horror that you would get. So it really wouldn't persuade you very much. It would just say, yes, we know how much film, you know, in this genre can make. You know, we see box office reports too, but you know, depending on the investors that you're going to as well. I mean, if you're going out there and you're going to do an SEC filing yourself and do your own PPM, and you're going to go after, you know, doctors and dentists and all that, if you're producing, you know, something for a couple million, then those analytics being in your package are going to be much more, you know, influential and I think needed than if you're going to, you know, film finance company that does this all the time and runs their numbers internally anyway.
Yeah, that's actually a really good point. The fact where you're getting your money will have a huge impact on how useful those numbers are. If your investors can't do their own reports, those reports are going to be critical. So, and actually I want to just take 2 seconds to mention to people, if you have a question, you're going to send an email to nancy.fulton@yahoo.com. And I'll try to make sure that it's answered before the end of the call. I'm not going to interrupt the call to take questions because it's too distracting. So if you have questions, just send an email to nancy.fulton@yahoo.com and I'll make sure that they get answered by the end of the call. So the next step in the process is, I sort of group into the notion of developing your initial core production team and sort of determining real world costs and projected values. So, and so after the film analytics is done, I suggest that people engage a UPM to do a budget in a day of days if it looks like the financial forecasts indicate that producing this film is likely to be a good idea.
Yeah.
Does that make sense to you?
Oh yeah, for sure.
Cool. And then attaching a casting director and a sales rep or a producer's rep to work with the line producer and based maybe on the feedback you got from film analytics to start picking out a talent list based upon the target market for the film and the target distributors for the film and the amount that you can afford to actually put into the project. Would that sound like being the next step to you? Attaching the casting directress and the sales rep or producer's rep and then doing a cast list?
Well, it depends on what your ultimate goal is with the film.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I certainly don't need or want a sales rep, you know, to be involved at all when a package is coming to me, right?
Okay.
There's no need for that because that, you know, we'll be doing that, right, with our normal salespeople that we use and everything. So it depends on, you know, what your goals with the movie are. If you're going to be a producer who's going to hold on to the rights and you want to be, you know, self-distributing, or you just want to be selling territory to territory, or using a foreign sales rep to do that work and having the monies come directly back to you, then yeah, sure. Now different investors work different ways. Since most of the folks on our team have such production backgrounds and marketing distribution backgrounds. We're doing all of that. Now there's other finance companies, I'm sure, who just are really, they're giving you the equity as a loan with an interest rate. That mm-hmm. isn't how we work. But for folks like them, then, yeah, if you're the one who's going to have to be, engaging all the foreign sales reps and getting the money and getting to mm-hmm. theaters and all of that, then, yeah, certainly that would be, something you would need to do. But like I say, it depends on what your goals of the project are and how much of it you're going to be handling or not.
Right. So if it was a case that would you, if you didn't engage a sales rep or producer's rep at this point, would you just attach the casting director and work with the casting director to pick up sort of the key cast that you expect to use for this project? Would is that something that people who wanted to work with you, would you want them to do the casting, or would you want to do the casting or work with them to do the casting?
Yeah, we're open to, more developed and less developed project, and or I should say more packaged or mm-hmm. less packaged project, right? Mm-hmm. So for us, if you don't have that, that's fine, because part of our research of seeing, what we can make in other markets is going to be casting. So mm-hmm. We'll do, that engagement ourselves. But if you have the money to put a casting, director mm-hmm. on at this point and actually go out with, bona fide, offers to people, I don't know if you have money in escrow that you can make some bona fide offers and show me that, mm-hmm. It's not just an LOI that this actor is interested, but no, you already have them on board for certain dates and everything. Mm-hmm. It makes it a stronger package for sure. But on the other hand, it also makes it that it's encumbered now more, right? Because mm-hmm. it's got attachment to it. And maybe we would like to throw somebody else in there because we're doing another movie with a different actor, and this would be a great, follow-up movie. So we don't want to use the actor that you've already done a pay or play with, right? And now you got to mm-hmm. pay them, even though they're not going to do the movie. Mm-hmm. So I think, with the outline that we're running through, it's a great outline, but sort of a, preference to that, a preface to the outline is, for the producers to really determine what their goals with the project are, how attached they want to be to it, mm-hmm. how much of the sales and marketing do they want to do with it, how much of the foreign sales do they want to be doing with it, it's mm-hmm. that will determine whether they use all the steps in this outline that you're running mm-hmm. through, or if they'll just use some of the steps. They have to make some other decisions up front first before they decide if they should bring a casting director on board or not, or right. if they should do all that analytics and so on. Yeah.
So when they're working, when people are working with you, what you would expect them to do is to get the script together and bring you the script and the budget and an estimate of the rebates and so forth. And then at that point, you guys have enough information to decide most of the time whether or not you want to go forward. And if you do want to go forward, then you'll be working out cast details and working out doing more in-depth film analytics. And you'll probably also be getting, you don't need them to bring you a minimum guarantee, because in fact, you're going to go ahead and get minimum guarantees and so forth as part of your funding process. Is that correct?
Yes. But if they've done all that work, mm-hmm. None of it is going to make us not look at it. Mm-hmm. We'll still certainly look at it and say, because we work all different kinds of deals, as we know, no deals are the same, right? So mm-hmm. if something could be that we simply put money into it and, we allow the producer to be doing the rest of that work, to be dealing mm-hmm. with foreign sales agents and all that stuff. Other projects, we get projects that simply are, they're at the script stage, CAA, I sit there and listen to a bunch of different pitches and okay, I like that one. So I start talking about my development team, and it's just a script, you know, there's nothing else involved or attached to it at all. And then we decide if we want to go ahead and do all the rest of that work that's going to be involved with it. So, yeah, for us, we don't do it only one way. So if you want to do that work, because those are the goals you have as far as how attached you're going to be for, you know, with that project, then sure, bring it to us. Bring it to us with everything you want to be doing on it.
So do you want, is it worth it? Would you recommend that if somebody thinks they have a really good project and they're at the part where they've got a script and a budget that's done by a bondable UPM, at that point they could fire off a query letter to you saying, this is what I have, this is the budget, this is the genre, and maybe film analytics if they happen to have done them. And then at that point you can say, you know, looks okay. You know, I'm not interested enough that I want to go through the process of packaging it. So maybe go find us some talent you think would be good and then come on back. In other words, can people approach you and then say, this is what I have so far. And then you can let them know what next steps they need to undertake to make the project more attractive to you.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, because, you know, we get things in various stages. Like I say, some are script only, you know, some are fully packaged. And depending on what our interest might be, would determine if we say, you don't need these things or you need more of these other things. You know what I mean?
Right. So if people reach out to you, with a good, clean, clear communication, at when they've got sort of the budget, the screenplay, and maybe analytics, so there's some idea of how much it's likely to earn. If they reach out to you at that point, then if there's anything else that needs to be done, then you can go ahead and direct them to, or you can say, it's not our cup of tea. Nothing you do to this thing would make it more attractive to us, and that kind of handles the problem of what they should be working on next. Either they have to find somebody else who's going to be the funder, or they need to go on, and if they want to make it attractive to you, then you'll give them a laundry list of things you need to go that next step.
Exactly.
Cool. So in the next set of steps I have, and this, so I'm assuming that somebody, because most of the people that are in my events are usually doing their first film or maybe their first profitable film, and they're mostly taking on projects that are in the $1 to $5 million range, which, you know, there's some good ones. Purge, I think the first Purge was definitely, I have the statistics, but it was in that ballpark. So in that first, assuming that was sort of the people that I think are in my class, the next step I recommend is that after they've got a cast in mind, they try to get a minimum guarantee from a distributor. If they were working with you, they wouldn't want to do that because you'd want to be able to negotiate what the minimum guarantees were going to be. But if they weren't working with somebody like you and they got a minimum guarantee, they might end up getting, you know, a third or a half of their budget from that agreement by selling the U.S. rights or something like that, or selling rights to some particular company in some particular window. And then they could go and they would have the money from rebates and they would have the money from rebates and incentives, and that might get them sort of 3/4 of the way to the full amount they need to fund the film. And then they could, at that point, they could reach out to you, or they could reach out to a capital finance or investors to see if they can make up the rest of that gap. Is that accurate or not?
Well, you lost me a little bit there in the middle of it, honestly. But if what you're asking is,
so if
would
I get a
we
minimum,
prefer,
if I get a minimum guarantee, so I'm just creating a pack. I'm creating a package of funding. So in other words, let's say that I have to. Let's say my object is to get to 2.5 million, and I get a minimum guarantee for one third of that amount. Say 800K in the U.S. or some lame thing.
Coming to us to fill the gap then?
Well, no, wait. And then I would also have the incentives, which might, if I had like 30% incentives or 40% incentives, I might get to the point where I am, you know, $1 million down or less than $1 million down from having a fully funded film. At that point is when I'm expecting that most people would approach a capital finance company or equity investors in order to close, or both, to close that gap. because they have to get to 100% of the funding that they need.
Right.
Is that accurate?
Yes. I mean, once again, it comes down to, you know, who you're going to and how mm-hmm. much control you want to have as the producer, you know, and mm-hmm. do you want to own all of it because you've raised all the money for it, or you're just looking for a buyout, or, you right. know, once again, it depends on your goals on it. But, you know, I have to say that, you know, the folks that, you know, that we get packages from, you know, they're more on the studio side or on that level. So they're established producers. So when they come to us and they already have, you know, certain guarantees somewhere or rebates or et cetera, you mm-hmm. know, they have a track record of doing that and mm-hmm. we know them as producers and their production company, and they've been distributed mm-hmm. by studios that I work for and all of that. So therefore, you know, we'll say to those folks, you know, like I was, my Chinese partner and I were, you know, listening to, you know, David Zucker was pitching us some material, and then somebody like that, when he says, you know, his producing team has, you know, these other guarantees in place and everything, I, you know, we're fine with that because they've done that before enough, right? Mm-hmm. And it's a budget, you know, that's not under $5 million.
Right.
So it comes down to, you know, the track record of the producer as well, too. Mm-hmm. Because if somebody is a kind of first-time producer and it's a film that's under $5 million, it's not really something that we're going to, you know, it doesn't fit into our business model. So that's not something we would be looking at anyway.
Right. Right. And so I think the section that's talking about distribution and finance is for people who aren't in a position to be able to work with you because they're not established enough. And because they are doing a film that is their first film, their first real film, which, you know, is in the $1 to $5 million range, which I think, you know, maybe we should all think about starting. It's not a bad way to start, you know. Little film before your big film, you know.
Oh, you have to. I mean, God, like I say, Steven gave me $1,000 for my first short film, and it was, you know, practically the entire budget, let me tell you. So, yeah, you have to start somewhere. So, I highly recommend that if you are a producer and you're doing, let's say, $1 million or $2 million movie, mm-hmm. Or let's say three, and you're basically just going around trying to fill the pieces of the pie of where the money is coming from. And yeah, absolutely. If you're going to be hand-holding that movie all mm-hmm. the way through the box office receipts, mm-hmm. then sure, you want to go out and get as much, you know, minimum guarantees as you can, get as much, you know, the best rebates that you can, mm-hmm. get everything you can, yeah.
Okay, cool. And again, it's if they were approaching you because they did happen to have a $5 million film, they could approach you at the stage where they just had the budget, and if you liked it enough to step in at that point, then they wouldn't do any of the rest of the stuff because they wouldn't have to because you'd be doing it all. So,
right, exactly.
And also that, which also addresses the issue of the single purpose entity and the private placement memorandum mm-hmm. and the business plan and so forth. If somebody is nursemaiding their first project from soup to nuts, following this outline that I've given, because it is their first project, then they, at this point, they would create the single purpose entity and the PPM and do the business plan and so forth. Whereas if they were working with you, they wouldn't have to create that because you would probably just be buying the rights, correct? You would be buying.
Yes, exactly.
They would be one of the productions under your umbrella.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Cool. So the next thing is, and I think we've sort of been talking about it all the way along, is that it's in the model that I outlined. Basically, it is exactly what you've described. You're building all the pieces. You're filling all the pieces of the pie. You're basically building the production and putting together the financing and figuring out the distribution and doing the forecast and so forth, so that you, when you're done, you've got a solid project. And when there's an amount that needs to be left over, I'm suggesting that that's when you approach investors. And we've already talked about the fact that people working with you would normally be approaching you before they have distribution and stuff in place. Generally speaking, if you're thinking about the kind of investors that put money into projects from 1 to 5 million, can you sort of talk about having spoken to many investors and having worked with investors on in a wide variety of other contexts, that I tend to describe the notion of, I tend to tell people, it's like investors like it when it's add money and stir, mostly, not in your particular case, but because you have, you're bringing a lot more to the party than just money. But people, I would think at the one to five, this low budget place we're talking about would normally be, they would want you to bring the entire thing to them. And then they would want to be able to put in their money. And then they would want you to actually go do the film right then. It's like, okay, like, don't bring it to me and then say, I need to go round up 15 other things. Like, bring it to me when putting my money in is actually going to make it go. Is that correct, you think? Or is that an accurate?
Yeah, I would say for sure. I mean, because when you think of, you know, folks who have done that successfully, like Napoleon Dynamite, right? You know, they went out and got that money from, you know, multiple sources and just kept filling the gaps. And, you know, they were, you know, one of the rare and fortunate ones that, you know, did very well that way and obviously did the majority of the work because they didn't have, you know, a film finance company that just came in and bought everything and did all of the work, et cetera. Mm-hmm. So I think that the type of investors, I mean, for instance, the Chicago fund that mm-hmm. I manage, they, you know, that's a private family. They're looking for particular kinds of films to invest into. They're still studio size and everything, but they, you know, they don't want to have anything to do with the actual production or marketing or any of that. You know, they're just putting their money into a project that they think is worthwhile to be done mm-hmm. and then getting a return from it. So I would think smaller investors in the, you know, 1 to 5 range, mm-hmm. You know, they're folks that have money and just want to make a profit back. You know, there's all kinds of investors in the world out there. Mm-hmm. So I think it comes down to who you are pitching and presenting to, how much they're going to require that you have ready to go and be done, mm-hmm. you know, so that they don't have to do anything.
Right. So maybe it does make sense then to, and maybe in all the cases, it makes sense to start reaching out to the people that you think are likely investors early, so that you can figure out, you can find the ones that seem most attached to the project and find out sort of what their objectives are. And when you talk about Napoleon Dynamite, I just have a question. If you were talking to the guy that made Napoleon Dynamite from the position that you're at now, would you have said, you know, maybe, dude, you should have figured out how to make a film that was $5 million? Instead of a film that was, you know, this really inexpensive film, because he took a bigger risk than maybe he had to. If he had spent time getting the right people on board to do the project, he could have approached somebody like you and he would have been in a different position when it came to producing that film. It wouldn't have been such a risky adventure. Do you think that's accurate?
Well, I would never suggest that somebody does, you know, their project one way or the other. I mean, everybody has to make their own decision of how they want to do it and how much risk they want to take and mm-hmm. how much hand holding they want to do all the way through the process. So mm-hmm. no, I mean, I wouldn't tell somebody, oh, you should have done it this way or you'd be better positioned this way. I'm totally mm-hmm. up to them, obviously.
Cool. All right. So, because I think that's one of the questions I think people often have is there's that question, for example, I just talked to a woman who's a fairly famous black actress producer, and she said, you know, I don't do studio films. I have a development deal and I don't do studio films because it's just too much hassle and I don't like the kind of films they want to do. She says, so all the films I do are going to be, I fund them all and they're all going to be in the $3 million range because I know I can make my money back. So she says, when people bring me projects and they're like $6 million or whatever, I'm just like, well, it's not for me because I'm not going to spend $6 million on a project. And
yeah, absolutely. There's people on that side of the spectrum and then people obviously on the total other end of that spectrum. So mm-hmm. yeah, I mean, one thing I would say, which, you know, you made me think when you were talking is, you know your investors well, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And I would recommend that you know what their requirements are and what their objectives for this investment is, way before you bring it to them. You know, you don't want to go to them and say, hey, here's the package, this is the money you'll make back. And we think it's a done deal and a no brainer, when maybe you should have gone in or could have gone in and said, hey, you know what, here's the package for it, but I know that you have another company that does this, and we thought maybe we could get some exposure for that other company if we did this in the movie. And we know you own some properties, you know, with your other company in Hawaii, and we thought, what a great way to showcase those properties by shooting parts of this film down there, blah, 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 right? Mm-hmm. You know your investors, so know how you can make it more attractive to them, you know, and know what their needs are in order to, you know, dole out the money, you know what I mean?
That's really, that's very good advice. Before the end of the call, I'd like to sort of chat with you about how people can, one, identify investment groups, and then to correctly and appropriately approach them. But right before we move on to that topic, I want to confirm two things. So again, my background working on with a wide variety of investors over the years is, I don't think I've ever heard an investor say, I invest in, what matters to me only is the project. They always, if there's going to be a team involved, they're investing in the team. In other words, they look at the people that are involved in the project, and ultimately they're going into business with those people. So what matters to them is not just the metrics of the project, but specifically the people that they're working with, their backgrounds, their skill sets, their manner and attitude, and so forth. Would you agree that that's like a make or break thing for the kind of investments that you make? For the projects where you're keeping the producer and the writer and so forth in the project for the entire, you know, entire run of the work? Or
yeah totally, I would say that. You know, unless you are just offering a buyout of the property, then you know those people aren't gonna be involved anymore, so you don't care. Mm-hmm. You know, you don't care anything about it then. But just depends on how you work as an investor. If you are a hands-off investor, you know, and you need to trust those people, you need to rely on them, know that they're going to communicate well, know that they're going to keep you in the loop on the things that they're supposed to contractually, then yeah, obviously, you know, that can make or break a deal. You know what I mean? The people that are involved with it, if you don't have that trust or the track record that's required to make that investor comfortable, then yeah, obviously that is going to break that deal. But if they're just offering a buyout, you know, on it, then there's nobody attached. So it's just all about the project.
That makes total sense. And then the other thing I would say is for when people, I think it's one of the other things that I've noticed a lot of, I think a lot of people that are filmmakers or call themselves filmmakers, a lot of times are really focused on getting the project out the door, which is probably correct in some sense. But what they don't, a lot of times, I don't hear them talking about or seeming to understand is that it's not just, you know, the deal's not done when they get funding. It's a multi-year relationship. So you and your financial partners are going to be working together for a long time. You're going to produce the project, and then revenue is going to come in for both of you. You have to get dished out to people on the right timetables, and with, you know, and if there's problems that come up during production or in distribution or anywhere along the way, you guys are kind of in it together. So is it, do yeah. you, when you're working with people, is it important to you that they see it and understand it as a multi-year relationship, that they perceive and indicate that we look forward to working with you in the years to come, even though we might be doing one little project, it's still going to be a thing.
Right. Yeah, for sure. I mean, it is years. You know, that it's going to be taking to get all the revenue, you know, to be coming back in. So, yeah, I mean, absolutely. I mean, I don't know anybody who doesn't think of it that way. Unless, once again, like I say, somebody's just offering to buy out a project from you. But if you're going to be there, you know, you're going to be actually producing it, and you're going to be sharing those revenue streams through your 7-year term or whatever terms you've made with people. And yeah, I mean, you know, you're going to be dealing with them for a couple of years.
Cool. And also,
good relationship.
it's a good relationship. But the other thing is, if you are you saying also, I'm curious on the projects that you currently fund. Let's say it's the case that somebody brings you something that is that you do get something that that goes somewhat big. So it does turn into something that has, you know, a second, you know, a sequel, or it is franchised in some way. In that case, you would be, even if you've done a buyout, would you normally buy all of the rights and then you wouldn't be working with them on it? Or would you be working with it if they, if you'd done a buyout of them? Like, do you buy literally all rights 100% or do you buy all rights to the particular film? And then if there's a sequel, then you're, you'll be back working with them again.
Yeah, no, I mean, all deals are different, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Some, you know, producers or writers, I mean, writers in particular, more so, I would say,
yeah.
You know, writers who have done something and we've done a deal at the script stage, mm-hmm. You know, we want to keep, we do want to keep them more involved and on board for, you know, potential sequels. Mm-hmm. Sometimes if it's a producer who's bringing us something and we would prefer to get that over to the studio and let the studio do it, mm-hmm. and it's just a buyout, then it's like, it's going to be a one-time deal. And, you know, they're, you know, they may meet, they may see some money in residuals if we work that into part of the deal. Mm-hmm. I shouldn't, you know, but, you know, we're a business like everybody else. You're trying to make the best deal for your business, you know, mm-hmm. a fair and equitable deal for everybody involved. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, our lawyers and your lawyers are bantering the deals back and forth, and hopefully we come up with, you know, something that's, you know, a good, happy medium for everybody.
That's really cool. I, and it's interesting that you make a distinction, the, in between somebody who's a producer who's bringing somebody else's project to you versus a writer or a writer producer who's bringing, who's, who you probably, if it's successful, you might be working with later. And the reason I brought it up is because that's another reason that's a multi-year relationship. If the object of the game is actually to have something successful, and something successful creates not just one film or one property, but creates a whole bunch of property. And in that circumstance, it becomes even more important that, that the people that you work with are people that you like and trust. It just, you know, everybody yeah. has to be comfortable. Cool. So yeah. I'm sorry, I keep cutting you off because there's this little delay in the...
Delay, yeah, I know. Sorry for me sitting. I'm doing the same thing.
So can you talk for a minute? I think most... one couple of different things. One is, and I think most people that aren't in your position and haven't been in your position don't know what... the financial advantages for an investor are. For example, there's, and I don't know if it's meaningful to talk about them, but for example, if there's section 181 or the ability to invest in a film and you know, for small-time investors, we're going to hit the alternative minimum tax. They can take, you know, they make $500,000 a year. They can push $200,000 or some ridiculous quantity of money into a film, and they don't, that will make it so they pay way less tax that year. So that's sort of one benefit for some people in terms of making film investments. But can you sort of talk about the reason why you and other investors elect to invest in film as opposed to other kinds of intellectual property or other kinds of investments? Like, you know, why aren't you investing in real estate, for example?
Yeah, I was going to say, I think it's because you have to be nuts. Because, you know, because the film business is obviously so volatile, and it's the same as Vegas. You know, there's, it's a total, total gambling game for sure. So I can't speak for other investors, but for myself in managing funds and doing the work that I do with, you know, other equity investment partners and so on, personally, for me, it's just because of my love of film and getting hopefully something of value out to the general public. That value could be pure entertainment value. It could be a message driven project, you know, that value. Mm-hmm. But, you know, ultimately it has to make its money back and preferably and a little bit more because then I'm not doing my job on the business end of it and people, you know, pay me or put money in my hands in order to make a profit. So, I mean, believe me, if I have, some good friends with a lot of money, I don't say, oh, go invest in the movie business. that's for darn sure.
Yeah, and it's kind of an interesting thing, because if let's think about J.K. Rowling. So this woman's sitting in like a little pub in the middle of nowhere. She's got no money, right. And she's just got her kid, and she's sitting there and she's writing this thing, which turns out to be one of the world's, let's call it at least the last, 50 years worth of, just that one piece of intellectual property has generated an incredible amount of money. So to some extent, you can't say it wasn't a great investment, because it was a great investment, right? Her investment of that time to create that project, and everybody who put people who put money into the first films and so forth, they made a very smart investment that in something that had no, literally was a stack of paper, not even paper, notebooks before she got involved. So you can create the thing about film or about media, intellectual property, is you can create an empire out of thin air. And I think from my perspective, that's one of the things I find the most interesting about it. Disney is an empire built out of thin air. They make it over there. They just make it. They make they made the Little Mermaid, they made all of these things that never existed until they existed. And then now they own them outright, and they make billions of dollars in merchandising and revenue from media through that. Uh-huh. So I think that's one of the things I like about it, is it's like, what other business is that,
All right. Yeah.
So can you give me some notions of how, you've mentioned getting acquainted with your investors as quickly as possible. And I think most filmmakers don't really know where they would mix and mingle or learn about companies like yours. They don't know what they would Google online. Would they Google like film finance company? Right. What would they look, how do they start researching the kind of people that might fund their projects?
Right. I would say really the best way for you to, for people to do that, is to attend as many of the major markets as you can. And network, there. That's always a good starting point. Of course, you got to buy a plane ticket to get there and, have your hotel and blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. But that's where, a lot of the players obviously are at. We're at all the major markets, and we're either meeting with, producers and listening to project pitches, or we're just keeping up our good relations, like you mentioned, with our foreign sales reps in Europe or Asia. So that's where you're going to find people that, do that kind of work, obviously. I don't know that they're, a long time ago in production, well, it still exists, but the LA 411, was just basically a resource book where you could find your grips or camera rental gear, blah, blah, blah. And I don't know of anything that really is going to tell you, oh, here's, the 25 busiest, film finance companies currently. So I don't really know what the answer to that is. I started to run into finance companies and people just at the markets or producing something and being over at AFM and, folks would see something and they would come to me and say, hey, is that, do you own that property? Are you repping it, or did you produce it or direct it or what? Mm-hmm. We like that kind of picture, in that sort of budget range, and we invest in things like that. And they already had their good relations with foreign sales reps and so on, so they saw potential for some good investments. So I would also recommend that, if you have projects, you want to get them out there on the festival circuit as much as you can, as well as into any of the markets, so that you can, while you're pitching and promoting that project that's already done, that you've got your posters made up for the next three projects that you're looking for financing on, right? Mm-hmm. So that investors You know what I mean? When they come to your screenings or foreign sales agents, et cetera, you literally are saying that at the beginning of your screening, well, here's the next three films, you know, that we can slate A, B, and C, and it's this amount of money. So, you know, we'd love to talk to investors after the screening, et cetera. You know, a million different ways to try and do it, but, you know, you want to be in the places where they are. And those are certainly some of the places, you know, where they are.
Cool. And generally speaking, the kind of company that does this kind of investment is called a film finance company or film fund. Is that generally, like, if you were to name the kind of company it is?
Yeah. And I mean, you know, if you're talking like the majors, like, you know, Europa Corp or something, or, you know, the Relativities, you know, you're not, yes, you'll find them online, but you're not going to be able to just go ahead and send them over your project, you know. Mm-hmm. You know, same thing goes for us. You know, we don't take material that's just coming from anywhere. You know, it's got to come through somebody's lawyer, or the majority of our material comes, you know, from the major agencies, you know, either WME or ICM, mm-hmm. UTA, and of course CAA, but and lawyers that we deal with regularly. So even though you might be able to find the larger ones, it doesn't mean you're going to be able to have access to them. Mm-hmm. But, you know, that being said, when you're over in Ken and you're at a screening or you're at some networking party or whatever, you will run into, you know, the VP of finance at Relativity, and you'll tell you, you'll be able to pitch them, you know, the projects you're doing and so on. They'll give you his card and say, okay, well, you know, hit me up or send it over to this person or XYZ, you know, or like, well, mm-hmm. we don't take things this way, but you can do it this way, whatever. But it's very difficult, you know, to just call around to companies and say, hey, I want to send you something. How do I do it? You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. As we all know, the industry has the gatekeepers along the way. And you've got to get through those gatekeepers, you know, in the right way in order to get to the people that you really need. But, you know, I can't tell you how many times I've met the people I've needed to know just by, because I was in the vicinity, you know what I mean? Because I was in the elevator at, you know, that hotel in Toronto, or I was at, you know, this screening in Berlin or whatever. I mean, it's like, mm-hmm. it's amazing. All the people that are there, the real people in the real industry, that's where we're all at. So it's like, you meet a heck of a lot of people there.
Mm-hmm. I think it's very true. What you're saying is something that I think is very true, which is a lot of good business happens face to face. One of the things that was interesting when I just interviewed Slated is they have a new executive producer service, which basically they actually have relationships with CA and a whole bunch of folks. And if they like your project and it scores well on the metrics that they have, you can bring them on board as an executive producer. And then they do they start bringing in the investors that, the investors that work through their platform that are active investors. And so I think that for people that are entirely new to the industry, there might be some sort of an option for having somebody front them in terms of if they have difficulty meeting people face to face. Because the things that you describe, I think I don't really have trouble meeting people that way, but I know other people who the idea of going to a film festival and chatting people up is, I don't know what would be less likely. I mean, them turning into a unicorn would be not. It's like, it's just never going to happen. And it's not that they're not talented people or good at business. It's just, they don't have that gene, you know, they don't feel comfortable making relationships in a face-to-face way like that. Maybe it's impossible for them to do well in the business, but I did see something that looked like it might be.
I was going to say, I would definitely agree with that last thing, because you can't do well face-to-face. I mean, it's, you know, unless you're just a reclusive writer, then that's okay. But if you're a producer or you're needing money and whatever, mm-hmm. it will be impossible if you don't have the talent and ability to have people like you and want to spend time with you.
Yes.
And, you know, I mean, that goes down to just, you know, being anywhere at any time. But I mean, pers- personally, years ago, I used to just go to over to the Lowe's Hotel in Santa Monica. So mm-hmm. if people are living here locally in LA, instead of buying a ticket to go to Toronto or Cannes or whatever, mm-hmm. you know, AFM over at Lowe's or wherever next year, and don't even buy a ticket to the market. Instead, you hang around the Starbucks that's right around the corner, or you go into the lobby and you hang around the lobby. I used to hang around the lobby year after year at the American Film Market, and I would just, you know, walk out of there with tons of business cards, you know, from Japanese buyers, from mm-hmm. German investors, just everybody, because you have to hit up every single person you see, see what it is that they do and how you can help them and how they can help you. I mean, I would always recommend you go after somebody, you know, with the mentality of what can I do for them before you start thinking about what they can do for you. You know what I mean? Right, you've always got to make it interactive that way.
I 100% agree. And in fact, I tell people that that's one of the most important things you can do is realize that, just like when you were talking at the beginning of our chat, you said, these are the groups that I work with, and these are the things that the kinds of projects that I'm looking for, and these are the requirements that I have to meet in order to do my job. And all of those things, you're stating the needs that you have and the problems that you face in doing your work, so that means that people who want to work with you are going to be solutions to those problems. So you know, and I think that seeing it from a position, it's very empowering to realize, to start with the sentence, well, what does this guy need and how can I help him? Like, if I don't have the solution that he needs, do I know somebody who has something really good that he would really like? So, like, knowing other filmmakers that have really good projects and being able to say, you know, I don't have what you want, but I know this guy who's got something truly amazing, you know, and then that also has been, in my experience, has been a really good way to make contacts with people, is really just to tell them about other people that are amazing, you know? So is there any topic that we didn't address that you think we should have?
No, I mean, you know, obviously there's, you know, you could talk about this endlessly. Actually, I was wondering, I think this is a 90-minute call, right? So we're getting close to the end.
We're getting close to the end. That's why I was asking.
You know, I wish there was some magic, you know, formula of how to get money for your movie. You know, I wish I was able to find that, you know, many years ago as well. The studios continue to adjust and try and figure out new ways to do that year after year. You know, mm-hmm. the big independent established producers continue to try and find new ways to do that as well. It's like with the EB-5 program that I'm talking about. That's a way that's been around, but not a lot of people use it. And, you know, the government's always changing what the rules are. So maybe, you know, we might use that next year. We might not, who knows? So I wish there was some standard way of doing anything in this business, but there really isn't. So the biggest advice I think I would give is, number one, you know what it is that you really want out of that particular project. I know if you want to be dealing with it for the next 3 years, as you mentioned, you know, a multi-year, you know, relationship with an investor and that project and all the problems that, you know, can potentially come with it. Or if you want to simply sell that thing off and move on to another project, or the various, you know, possibilities in between those two, you know, spectrums. So know what it is you really want to get out of that project. What are your objectives and goals for that particular project? Know the investors that you're going after, why you're specifically going to them, how you can make it more attractive to them in any way possible besides just give me money and I promise this thing will be great. That's certainly not enough or the best approach. So, you know your investor really well, educate yourself as much as possible about what they do and how you can help them do it better or make, you know, more profit, which is why they're a business. I would say also really to lay out a plan for yourself, you know, as far as year after year, you know, the amount of projects that you want to have, when you're willing to cut projects loose because, you know, you haven't been able to make that one move forward enough. You know, set some real, you know, deadlines and timelines for yourself, because I've seen so many people, and I've certainly been guilty of myself over the past, you know, 20 some years of, you know, holding on to things too long or having too many things going at the same time, and you never really make a lot of progress on any particular one. Instead, it's like, you know, whittle it down, focus, be just like a business person, do a SWOT analysis on your business, you know, to figure out which has the best potential, you know, and then, you know, cut the other babies loose and really focus so that you can have some success on a few rather than having little or no success on a lot, or having those other ones really weigh you down and take away your time and energy that you could be putting towards something more successful. So those are a couple of my thoughts I would have.
I think that's really good advice. I think I've seen exactly the same thing. People will decide, this is my, I have to do this film before I do this, you know, this other film or these other projects I have. And it's like, that thing is never going to fly. You, that, no, will never happen. Stop playing with that. Or the other thing is, put it down for now, and maybe you never know if it'll come, if somehow or other, right, it will magically come back. You know, we all have, you know, projects we love in a drawer that we go, one day I will make this thing, but we don't spend our whole lives trying to make the darn thing. So we have a couple of questions that I think you've already answered, but I just want to confirm. The one question we have is, do you have your own internal sources for film analytics? You don't have like a particular firm that you actually go to that's like one of the commercially available film analytics companies. Is that correct?
No, that's correct. All internal.
All internal, cool. And which is based on your fact that you have all these relationships with distributors who can give you literally live data based upon, you know.
Yes.
Cool. Yeah. Somebody asked the question about Netflix. And so the kind of when you're producing stuff, do you fund with specifically films that are going to get theatrical release, or do you film stuff that's going to be going on, that's going to be targeted at premium web channels, or does it not, that you don't really, or are you sort of distribution agnostic? In other words, it's whatever distribution is financially rational and whatever market exists for this particular project will be fine.
No, we are theatrically oriented, just because then we're able to build on that theatrical release, the other ancillary, you know, revenue streams. So, yes, we focus on theatrically released product.
Right. So you start at the very top of the chain. So somebody asked a question about how people can find out about tax incentives and rebates. And that's not something that an investor tells you. That's something that a UPM or line producer that you hire to budget a project, that's what they tell you, is they know what the rebates are. If they're a good UPM and they have lots of credits, and why are you hiring one that doesn't? And there's somebody who can get a completion bond and somebody who can get insurance, then they're usually competent enough to be able to tell you what the tax incentives and rebates are, and you can incorporate that into your funding solution. And then let me go see what the last question is. And this is a question I think you've already answered in detail, but if somebody's new to features, then it's not impossible or inconceivable, but if you have a new producer and they're new to features, they're less likely to get funding from you unless they are bringing you the Holy Grail. Is that correct or no? Like, I mean, brand new people?
I would say yes, that's correct for sure. But when you say unless they're bringing you like the Holy Grail, I mean, I don't know what that is. You know, I mean, it's like, that's such a subjective thing that,
somehow, rather they talk J.K. Rowling's into giving them the rights to Harry Potter 9.
Well, yes, that's what I was going to say. If it's Right, if it's Harry Potter 9, but if it's not, but if it's Harry Potter that hasn't been tested or proven, and it's just on paper, and it's, you know, somebody who hasn't, you know, done anything, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, then the only way we would ever see that or consider that is through the Capital Fund screenplay competition that we read for, and that's why we agreed to be one of the companies that reads there, because we do tend to get a lot of, I don't want to say derivative material, but we do tend to get a lot of material from the same sort of 20-25 studio approved writers of what, you know, they expect the studios and finance companies are looking for, and we weren't getting a lot of just sort of, you know, fresh ideas from a 15-year-old kid in Idaho. You know, that could be a great idea, but, you know, he doesn't have the manager or the lawyer or whatever to submit it to us. So we do see a bunch of that sort of stuff from the competition, and it's great. We haven't found something yet that we've said, oh, that's great, we'll finance it. I mean, I think other companies have financed stuff out of there, but we haven't financed one from there yet. But I hope we do. I hope we find a great thing from there, and it's somebody who basically can avoid all of the things I had to go through over many years in the business, and they just like, wow, like, they want to buy my movie. Okay, great.
I don't know. So, I got to tell you, that you're not going to get too many people feeling sorry for you for, you know, getting to work with Steven Spielberg and Tom. I mean, at some point, they're just going to go, well, I'm not feeling sorry for you. I'm feeling sorry for me.
Yes, I understand. I felt sorry for myself for the first, I don't know, 8 or 9 years when I was, you know, just still cleaning up the coffee and sweeping all the floors. But yes, you know, the business is so hard. You know, you sacrifice so much if you really want to stay in it, as you know. And, you know, a lot of people get lucky, you know, very quickly. And a lot of people who are doing it for 20 some years and never get lucky. I mean, it does take, obviously, competence, persistence, but I really do believe it does, luck has a lot to do with it, you know what I mean? If you're still working the business for the love of it, then, and you're happy about that, then I think that's, you know, that's the right thing to do for you.
I think you're right. And I also think that well, but, you know, I used to work for a school for startups in the UK, teaching people how to start businesses. And I got to tell you, it's like every business has its bizarreness. And I think that, my husband works in apps, you know, and he's had really good success, you know, with apps. So it's, what's kind of interesting is that it is somewhat true. The harder you work, the luckier you get. And also the more that you, I think the people I've seen be successful are very analytical. And I think one of the reasons I run the events is because I kept going to events in Hollywood that purported to tell me how to fund a film or whatever, or produce a film or whatever the deal was. And I swear to God, I'd go to the event and come out thinking, I think I know less than when I went in. I think data actually got subtracted. I'm more uncertain than I was before. And then I'd have to go back and like reverse engineer it. And so one of the reasons that I think it is really important, I've decided it's very important to talk to people that actually are in a position to know what they're talking about and have demonstrated that they have a certain set of skills and have had certain success in doing things. Because I think their methods for doing things are entirely different from people who watched from the outside. Do you know what I'm saying? So
yeah, no, I understand that. I mean, like the executive producer, I mean, I would have never been able to, you know, work for Spielberg had I not proved myself for so many years and for a particular producer that I worked for so long and, you know, showed them that I would do it right and that they could rely on me and blah, 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 blah. So it's like you proving yourself, you know, for so long in order to get, you know, a little closer to something else. And, you know what I mean? And,
yeah,
and because of working, you know what I mean? It's like it you have to build. It doesn't, you know, I mean, unless your uncle is, I mean, Michael Bay or something. It's just like, oh yeah, come and do script development for me. You know, unless it's that way, which it certainly wasn't that way for me. You've got to kill yourself to prove yourself to, you know, every single person along the way so that they will allow you to get a step further and a step further and so on and so forth.
I agree. You know? And I also think that, I think it's exactly what you said in terms of the fact that you have to invest, you have to, because people are handing you more and more money as you go farther and farther along, and the amount of money that they're handing you, every film project to some degree is a Maserati that people are building in their front yard using homemade parts. You know, I mean, it's every project together. And so, and it's not, you can't get the time back or the money back, and you can't get the, even if you could make it so the film, you know, got back its original investment, you've lost the amount of money that you would have earned putting it into something else. So it's a very strange business from that perspective, that it's different from other businesses in the fact that you actually are going places and making something. It's not like, and you're not sitting in an office. You're going out someplace where things happen. The world. That's what makes it hard, I think. So it is truly a wonderful thing that you've invested so much time in talking to us this evening. And I think it's, I'm going to, with your permission, I'll go ahead and take the recording that you've, that you've been kind enough to make, and I'll turn it into a, I will turn it into a video, and send you a link to it so that you have I'll edit it and I'll send a link to the video to you. And then with your approval, I'll go ahead and make it available to all the people that are on my, that are on my list. I've got about 13,000 people at this point. And more than half of them are, producers or writer producers or actor producers and so forth. So it'll be very
great. Well, I appreciate it. I look forward to it. And thank you once again for, you know, doing what you're doing for all the people out there, because, you know, people have it easier because of the resources that you're providing them. So thanks for doing the work.
You're really kind. Thank you so much. And I hope you have an excellent evening. I'm sorry I've kept you up.
All right. Thank you to everybody out there. Good luck. And don't quit. Don't give up. If it's your passion, just keep doing it.
You're very kind. Have a great evening, man.
All right. Take care, Nancy. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.